can start. So basically, my topic is all about global civil aviation and aeropolitics in post-COVID-19 world. So first, I would like to explain what is global civil aviation or civil aviation. If you are talking about civil aviation, you know, it is, you know, one of the two major categories of flying, you know, where we are representing non-military aviation. Both private and commercial, it includes both private and commercial. And most of the countries in the world are members of the International Civil Aviation Organization, which is the highest authority, which look after all the standards which has been made for the aviation industry. And, you know, most of the countries who are members to this UN organization, ICAO, they work together to establish common standard and recommend practices for civil aviation through that agency. Now, if I talk about what exactly it includes civil aviation, but commercial and private, so scheduled air transport, including all the passenger, cargo flights operations, and regular scheduled routes, and general aviation, which includes all the civil flights, private and commercial, everything. So before going on to the main topic on which I want to talk about, which is aeropolitics, I would like to, you know, discuss a few things, how this COVID-19 has affected this aviation industry. What kind of effect it has, marked on this industry. So basically, this was the, this COVID-19 was, you know, it, the kind of effect it made on aviation industry, it was, more than ever, the shock which, you know, implemented on this industry has never been seen in the past, though aviation industry has seen so many breakouts, like during 9/11 attacks and SARS. At that time also, aviation industry got, you know, shook, but the kind of effect COVID-19, has on the aviation industry, it devastated the industry, very strongly. So, and due to the, shutdown, which has been implemented by the government on aviation industry, it basically, shrunk the business value of the airline industry. So the effect majorly, it's not about one country, it has affected, the global aviation industry. Now, I would like to move on to the aeropolitics. Aeropolitics, if I talk about aeropolitics, it's a very vague term. It doesn't include only legal and economical regulatory structures that are placed in between two or more states. So aeropolitics in the sense, any kind of legal procedure, any kind of economic regulatory structures, any kind of state center activities which has been going on for the aviation industry, like infrastructure provisions must be there for airline industries, state investment, which, government provides for their aviation industry, for their country's airline industry, and other, regulatory frameworks governing global air transport. So it includes everything. What kind of legal framework is there, which is contradicting between the international organization which are working for the aviation industry, like the very superior authority, which is UN agency, the International Civil Aviation Organization. It has been tasked with to provide the global oversight and leadership of regulatory provisions which are centering around the global passenger air transport. Specifically, this organization worked during the times of crisis, because at that time, the contradictions between all the other organizations which are working with the airline industry, they started, getting contradictions in their standards, where this organization comes in and try to resolve all the problems which industry is facing. So now I'm going to talk about during the COVID-19, how ICAO, which is International Civil Aviation Organization, worked and how it actually tried to resolve various conflicts between the different states and different and the state and the airline industries, how they were in, you know, they were against each other due to so many restrictions which government was putting on the airline industry. So first I would like to talk about one convention which happened in 1944, being a founding document of International Civil Aviation Organization. You know, this, it was the basic document for ICAO, which includes, you know, which states that all these states which are the members of this convention, they have to conclude an air service agreement, which are ASAs. All the countries which are the members of this convention, Chicago Convention, it is a basic foundation document of ICAO, which, you know, always worked during the time of crisis. So, and it also specifically mentions that the framework for dealing with international health emergencies, this Chicago Convention will be there. All the rules, regulations, standards, whatever will be made by the agencies that has to comply with the structure of Chicago Convention. So as we all know, the kind of role aviation planes spreading the communicable disease, and this disease, when it, you know, broke out, first case was, you know, came in light during December 2019, and since then it has been increasing. So the ICAO, when the cases starting increasing till March, there was no conflicts between the government, airline industry, because the kind of effect it has shown after March, and the kind of restriction which government started putting after March, then the, you know, legal problems started getting in the picture. So now I would like to talk about ICAO roles, how it, you know, managed to reduce the conflicts. So ICAO ki agar main baat karu, it's, you know, arguably it has, you know, a paramount role in context of 2020 pandemic, because whatever framework it has been made before COVID-19 and whatever agreements were already there in between the government, in between the government of different countries, different states, and support which aviation industry was getting from government, it was totally different before COVID and after COVID. So I would like to tell you about, you know, Chicago Convention. First of all, I would like to talk about what it mentions, that how ICAO will solve the conflicts which are there in between the states, governments, and the airline industry. Article 14 of Chicago Convention specifically mentions that every contracting states are those states which have signed the convention, that is Chicago Convention, which is the basic document which by which the civil aviation industry works, the framework which has been provided by the Chicago Convention. So Article 14 of the Chicago Convention states that every contracting states, you know, have to, you know, take effective measures to prevent the spread by means of air navigation. Any kind of epidemic is there, any communicable disease is there, they have to take immediate effective measures to prevent it. Right. And from time to time, they have to decide to designate and, you know, they have to keep in close consultation with the agencies which are concerned with the international regulation relating to sanitary measures applicable to aircraft. So basically, Article 14 is trying to say that each and every member, each and every international contracting party who has signed the Chicago Convention has to take immediate effects to prevent the spread of any communicable disease which has been there. Okay. Apart from that, so many provisions are there which has been provided by the convention, but first I would like to explain few provisions, and then I will tell you how it got resolved and what kind of problems airlines were facing. Right. So there is one Annexure 9, which has been attached with the convention, Chicago Convention. In Chapter 8, it has been mentioned that all these states which are the members of this convention, who has signed the convention, with respect to communicable diseases, they have to establish a national aviation plan as well as national facilitation program, and some committee should be there who is looking after the communicable disease which has been spreading. Apart from that, now the one other organization comes into the picture, that is WHO. It has been mentioned that each and every single standard or any kind of practices, recommended practices or safety measures which has been made by any state during any epidemic, they have to be made in accordance with the international health regulations of WHO. Without the consultation or without the, it should be in accordance with the international health regulations, which, WHO provides when any kind of epidemics spreads. So now I would like to give you one example how the, these things started, how the contradictions between the government started, and which other organization came into picture. So I guess in April 2020, there was an announcement by Argentinian government that they banned all commercial sales on flights until September 1, 2020. It's a huge time. For 5 to 6 months, they banned the sales of commercials on flights. So now there, one other organization came into picture because it has the right to make so many provisions for the airline industry. That is IATA and International Air Transport Association. This also look after the aviation industry, how they are working. Now, when Argentinian government banned the commercial sales on flights, till September 1, 2020, so IATA came into picture, and they sent a letter to Argentinian government, and they asked them to whatever decisions they took, whatever decision to ban the commercial sales of commercial on flights, it was against the ASA, that is Air Service Agreement between the countries, between the country and the airline industry. But it was not actually clear. Why it was not clear? Because the Chicago Convention, which is the main, framework, which has been provided by the UN agency, or which has been signed by different countries, on the basis of which different frameworks and standards has been made. So it was silent on refusing airlines of trading partners airspace entry. That means countries can implement public health measures, but whether the airlines can refuse trading partners from entering into their airspace, that was not mentioned in the Chicago, in any provision of Chicago Convention. That is when the contradiction started, conflicts between the parties started. And IATA knew that the quarantine thing was there, that people has to be quarantined if they are, if they are traveling from one state to another state, from one country to another country, they have to be in quarantine. But there was nothing mentioned in that framework that whether aircraft operations should be restricted or not. And that is when it was the beginning of international legal challenges, started with scope and intent of ICAO's felicitation provisions. Whatever ICAOs, gave to people, that what kind of things they have to follow. So many things were not available in public domain, that what should they do, what airline industry should do, and how governments of different countries should make, laws for the airline industry during the pandemic. As we all know, aviation industry, it's a it's, you know, recognized as in biosecurity. So obviously there will be, you know, interest among states in aligning health policy with aviation policy. So anyhow, all the aviation companies, all the aviation, you know, industries, they have to include some health policies with their aviation policies. So, you know, but at that time, states were facing so many dilemmas that at one hand, they had to, you know, follow the preamble of the Chicago Convention, that signatory states, they have to create and preserve friendship and understanding among the nationals. So this is a provision or the preamble of the Chicago Convention, which may, you know, which states that all the states, all the signatory states, they have to create and preserve friendship and understanding among the nationals and peoples of the world. Yet it, you know, its abuse can become a threat to the general security. Again, ek taraf, you know, the states had to maintain the provision or the preamble of the Chicago government. And on the other hand, urgent health-related policies may or may not override this. So what I'm trying to say is that on one hand, they had to maintain the harmonization or the, you know, harmonized relation with the other states or with the people of the country. And at the same time, they had to make some emergency health-related policy as well, which were, you know, somehow they were contradictory to each other. Either they had to maintain the relation with the other states or the nationals and the people of the world, and at the second place, they had to, you know, include those health-related policy in their framework. It was, you know, states were in, you know, so much dilemma what they should do. And arising from this conundrum, you know, the question comes up is, you know, the question which comes up was that you know, states' responsibilities versus adherence to the Chicago Convention. Now states, you know, governments were, you know, very facing so much dilemma that what should they do? Either they had to fulfill their responsibility or either they had to, you know, adhere to the Chicago Convention for any ASA, Air Service Agreement, which they are going to be forced. So, you know, at that time, states were facing so many tensions as related to economy, social role of aviation, and they actually desired to preserve public health. And, you know, they had to follow all the international laws, standards, guidance with being a signatory to the Chicago Convention. So many things were there. All the different organizations were giving different standards for the aviation industry. So basically, when ICAO, when these conflicts started, ICAO, tried to resolve this conflict, and they actually established one, COVID-19 Aviation Recovery Task Force. And the main objective or aim behind it was to identify and recommend strategic priorities and policies for states and industry operators. Now they wanted some harmony between the airline industries and the states, different states, and all the rules and regulations which are already there, like Chicago Conventions were there, WHO's regulations were there. So how to maintain, how to adhere to all the international standards and all the frameworks which were there. So, you know, it was established in the month of April, and it started working in the month of June, I guess. And so basically, ICAO started working, and they gave 10 key principles and to make the recovery and make 11 recommendations. Like, if I give you one example, for economic and financial measures, the report which CART, that is COVID-19 Aviation Recovery Task Force, gave, it said that all the rules and regulations related to economy and financial measures for the airline industry should be inclusive, targeted, proportionate, transparent, temporary, and consistent with ICAO's policies while striking an appropriate balance of interest without prejudice to fair competition. That means they had to follow all the ICAO's recommendations which CART had given, and apart from that, they had to look for the fair competition. But apart from that, they also the main thing came into the picture was ICAO's recommendation. That was the only thing which now aviation industry had to follow. Now there was one example I would like to give you, like Argentinian government and IATA sent the notice to Argentinian government on the banning of commercial sales in the aircraft. Now this was just one case which occurred during the COVID-19. So ICAO thought that nothing is going to happen, that is just one case, but that was not the one case. Suddenly, after some time, three airline companies moved to the court, to the international court, and what they said that the UK, they moved to the court against the UK government, and the main reason behind it was they were not happy with the restrictions, their main thing which they wanted to convey to the court is that the restriction which UK government was putting on the aviation industry or the aircraft operation was excessively restrictive, which was taken without any consultation, and which was not based on any scientific theory, or I would say which was not taken with the proper consultation of with the experts. And in Chicago Convention as well as ICAO's framework, it was mentioned that each and every single government which whatever restrictions they are putting, they had to consult with the experts. So like this, so many countries, so many airline companies moved to court regarding the restriction which governments were putting. So this, the contradictions or the conflicts keep increasing between the government and the different airline industries, and in between airline industries and countries. Apart from that, when it comes to the resolution of conflicts, there were so many things which airline industry wanted from government. So during the COVID-19, all the operations were shut down. Government restricted the operation of aircraft. No one is allowed to fly. Everything shut down. Everything got shut down. So airline industries wanted some help from government. Here comes the role of politics in aviation industry. Legal frameworks were there, international organizations were there. Now they wanted some help from the government. What kind of help they wanted? Because airline industry, it's not about just you are going from one city to one country to another city through airplanes or aircrafts. It has so many operations, right? It has so many things. So despite strong growth in past years, the business of passenger transport it got shut down completely. So some airlines and related aviation sectors like airports, air traffic control providers, they actually signaled to their respective governments that now they need some financial support from the government in any form, like they can give them loans, grants, and other fee waivers. You must know that aircrafts, any airline company, when they operate any aircraft, so many other departments are there, so many third parties are already included with them. They are not operating any flight alone. So many people are already with them. So what they wanted is that because of the provisions in bilateral ASAs, like air service agreements, what they wanted that government should negotiate with other countries, then how they can operate the flights. they wanted, you know, financial support as well as some legal support from the side of government, that they should get into the picture and they should, you know, have a, you know, meeting with the government of different countries so that they can operate their flights. Apart from that, you know, international airlines, you know, were shut down and they were facing, so, and, you know, employees were waved off from their jobs. So government wanted to help, but again, government also were facing so many pressures. So first, with government financial resources, especially, you know, stretched with mass unemployment, because government had to help the airline industry as well as those people who were getting waived off from their jobs. So first, with government financial resources started getting stretched. Now they have to look after the mass unemployment. They have to look after the, you know, fiscal stimuli, and other industry were equally in need of financial support. So now there was a time when governments had to, you know, think about how aviation industry, you know, is important to that country. Because at that time, now how, what government did, what, you know, so what government did is they started helping airline industry in some or the other way. They were not able to provide the direct financial support to the airline industry. So what they started doing, they asked the different airline industries to, you know, reconcile their, you know, contracts with third parties. They, you know, government asked them to, you know, they asked airline industry to, you know, waive off. They asked them to, you know, in again restructuring their contracts which they are having, which they were having with third parties, like jet fuel, can, you know, like I would say financial capital injection was needed. But apart from that, what government did, they started giving loan guarantees, because during COVID-19, banks were very reluctant in providing the loans to the airline industry, because they were in so much loss. So they were not, you know, so much positive regarding giving loans to the airline industry. So in that way, government entered into the picture and they intervened in between and asked the government to, you know, ask the banks to provide the loans to airline industry without guarantees. Government took the guarantees. Low interest rates were provided. Somehow, tax relief were also given to the airline industry. So the policy makers, they actually deployed some, you know, adequate policy interventions during the time of COVID-19, like, you know, loans and loan guarantees, I told you. And, you know, because they were getting loan guarantees, so investors, the third parties, which are already involved in the operation of one aircraft, they, you know, they got the confidence in the restoration of airline industry. And, you know, they actually restored their confidence regarding the economic conditions of the airline industry. Apart from that during the COVID-19, the ability to access low interest loans or government backed financing was, you know, really important for a company to survive, and government actually helped. But some other measures which, you know, government would have given to the airline industry is, like, they should have, you know, included some employment wage subsidies. Unpaid leave program would have been started so that people who were getting laid off could get some other options, could get some money to, you know, survive during those times. Special employment program could have been started. And now the situation has, you know, started getting to normal. Now the, you know, airline industry is getting back to the normal, but now it's a new normal. Now what airline industry has to do, now they have to, you know, change their procedure, how they used to operate before COVID-19. Now they have to provide some new, you know, training to their employees, because the training which they got before COVID-19, it was totally different. And I think in this, at this place or in this regard, airline industries are failing somehow. Because in news some other day I have been heard, you know, I have been reading about it that so many crews and so many pilots, they have been complaining about it that, you know, the airline industries are not providing proper training to them that how to operate during the time of emergency situation, and they don't have proper equipments, they don't have, you know, any kind of safety measures have not been implemented during the flight operations. So now government has, you know, the aeropolitics, which I specifically talk about, their intervention was actually needed. One of my friends, she asked me how positive the intervention of politics, you know, in airline industry. So I would say that the intervention of politics or policy makers in the aviation industry during the during times of COVID-19 was really important, because they had to intervene, otherwise the industry would have collapsed very badly due to the intervention of policy makers, the loans, guarantees, financial capital injection at some extent, low interest rates, which were given to the airline industry, it helped them to get back to the new normal. Now, the airline industry are failing on their part because they are not following the norms which have been implemented or which have been provided by the government and different authorities to them. Because so many things are there which are coming in the public domain regarding the risks which airline industry is taking with the lives of so many people. So I think aeropolitics this time worked actually positively. Contradictions were there, conflicts were there, but again, the kind of support which airline industry or governments got from the international organizations, and the kind of help which they got, it was amazing. That is why people are getting back to normal. Aviation industry is getting back to normal. International flights are still not operating, but soon it will be started. Again, the main part which has to be followed is, which has to be, done by the aviation industry is still at, it's still not proper. It has to be done. It has to be followed properly. So that, the intervention of government is always not negative this time. I would say this intervention was really good. It should have been done. And otherwise, the conflicts would have been increasing, or, the industry, would have not been able to get back to the normal. Okay, so that's all I wanted to share. That is all what I wanted to share about the aeropolitics and aviation industry, what kind of effect it had and what has happened. Now you can ask anything if you have any question.
So thank you, Ms. Saloni. That was very nice. You gave an insight about the aeropolitics. I understand the Chicago Convention and the ICAO's agreements you were talking about. And certainly, ICAO has taken a lot of measures. However, the things could have been much better. That was your whole point about describing the things. Politics occurs everywhere, and so does the aviation is impacted through bad decision-making capacities. However, nevertheless, to say that we all have undergone in last 8 months a lot of, bad decision-making time has come, and our decision-making capabilities has been impacted because we all were confused. And now the things are getting better. Now we have accepted that COVID-19 is going to stay with us for a longer period of time, and let's roll with it. So I'm sure the future will be better. And like you also said, the same thing. Next few months, these are the months of acceptance, and then we will be able to flourish in aviation industry as well. Thank you, Saloni.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Captain Gupta.
Thank you, Captain Shikhar Gupta, for giving me this platform. It was amazing. I wanted to share these thoughts with someone, and you gave me that platform. Thank you so much for that.
I would just like to invite Raja Rajeshwari for formal call, vote of thanks. Raja Rajeshwari, over to you. Raja Rajeshwari, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Over to you.
Okay, sir. We have proposed a hearty vote of thanks to Saloni Tyagi for present gracing today's webinar. I hope, assure all the students and all the participants have note their note and use their in future and their career.